Thank you all for being here. I'm Catherine Morris. I'm the Sackler Family Curator of the Elizabeth A. Sackler Center for Feminist Art, and I'm pleased to welcome you all here tonight. The exhibition Judith Scott, Bound and Unbound was co-curated by myself and Matthew Higgs, and it has been a delight and a pleasure to live with the exhibition over the last few months. One of the things that I often say about being the curator for the Sackler Center for Feminist Art is that my priority is not necessarily to convince anybody that they should be a feminist, but rather to have a discussion about the fact that looking at visual culture in 2014 is something that is inevitably influenced by feminism, influenced by one of the most important art historical movements, certainly of the latter 20th century, and has an impact on the way that we look at almost any visual culture, including an artist like Judith Scott. I would never make a claim for Judith Scott being a feminist artist. I would, however, argue that because of feminism and other civil rights movements, including the disability rights movement, Judith Scott had the opportunity to become an artist. And part of the reason that we are able to look at what Judith Scott made and understand it as art is also because of the impact of theoretical thinking, including feminism. Before I turn this over to Matthew, who will introduce tonight's participants, I'd just like to thank a few people. First and foremost, I'd like to thank Elizabeth Sackler for making everything we do possible and for being a continuing supporter of all that we do. I'd also like to thank Arnold Lehman, the director of the Brooklyn Museum. I'm particularly grateful to the Council for Feminist Art and Marilyn Greenberg, who contributed to making tonight possible. Thank you for that. I'd also like to thank Jess Wilcox, our programs coordinator, who makes everything we do look effortless, so we appreciate that. Matthew, I'll introduce Matthew, who I said we'll introduce everybody else, we'll read. Matthew Higgs is a curator, writer, and artist. As director and chief curator of YCOM since 2004, he has organized more than 150 individual exhibitions and projects, showcasing the work of more than 500 international artists of all generations. Over the past 15 years, he has organized more than 250 exhibitions and projects in Europe and North America. His writings have appeared in more than 50 books, catalogs, and periodicals, including Art Forum and Frieze. Also a teacher, Matthew has been a lecturer at Goldsmiths College and the Royal College of Art, London. More recently, he was co-chair of the MFA program at the California College of Arts in San Francisco. Higgs has also lectured internationally and has sat on many panels and juries, including the 2006 Turner Prize at Tate Britain. Higgs has shown his own work internationally since 1992 and is represented in New York by Murray Guy. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Welcome to the Brooklyn Museum, everyone. Thanks for coming out on a wintry night. On behalf of myself and tonight's panelists, we'd like to thank everyone at the Brooklyn Museum and the Sackler Center for Feminist Art for organizing and hosting tonight's event. It's a great pleasure to moderate tonight's conversation that, as Catherine said, is being held in conjunction with the current exhibition, Judith Scott, Bound and Unbound, curated by myself and Catherine. And it remains on view until March the 29th, if you haven't already had a chance to see it. And I think the galleries are open until 10 p.m. tonight. It's a great pleasure to introduce tonight's guests, and I'll just give you a little brief of the background. On my far right, Massimiliano Gioni is the artistic director of the New Museum in New York and the artistic director of the Nicola Trissardi Foundation in Milan. Massimiliano has curated many international exhibitions and biennials, including the 55th Venice Biennial, which he directed in 2013, the 8th Going Jew Biennial in 2010, and the 4th Berlin Biennial in 2006 that he co-curated with Maurizio Catalan and Ali Sapotnik, among many others. During his 7-year tenure at the New Museum, Massimiliano has curated solo exhibitions of work by Clara Lydon, Carson Holler, Paul Chan, Urs Fischer, and most recently, it was just closed, the Chrysophilia exhibition, amongst others. Throughout his curatorial practice, Massimiliano has included the work of both self-taught and so-called outsider artists, established an ongoing curatorial narrative that received wider attention in his 2013 Venice curated exhibition, The Encyclopedic Palace. To my immediate right is Lynne Cooke. Lynne is the senior curator for special projects in modern art at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. between 2008 and 2012. She was the deputy director and chief curator of the Reina Sofia Museum in Madrid, Spain. Between 1990 and 2008, she was the curator of the Dia Art Foundation in New York. Cooke has organized many monographic exhibitions, including the 2012 survey of Rosemary Trockel's work, A Cosmos, presented in New York at the New Museum, that juxtaposed Trockel's work with that of a number of also so-called outsider artists, including Judith Scott. She organized the 2011 James Castle retrospective show in store at the Reina Sofia Madrid, and also Frances Elise's 2008 exhibition Fabiola at the Diaz Center at the Hispanic Society of the Americas, among many others. She recently contributed an essay, Orthodoxies Undermined, for the catalog for the 2013 exhibition, Great and Mighty Things, Outsider Art from the Jill and Sheldon Bonovitz Collection, which was at the Philadelphia Museum of Art. And she also contributed to the catalog for the current Judith Scott exhibition. And in the center is Lawrence Rinder. Larry Rinder is the director of the University of California, Berkeley Art Museum and Pacific Film Archive. He's held positions at the Museum of Modern Art, the Walker Art Center, and the Whitney Museum of American Art, where he was the chief curator of the 2002 Whitney Biennial. Among the many exhibitions Rinder has organized include In a Different Light, curated with Nayland Blake at the Berkeley Art Museum in 1995, and Create, which he organized, co-curated with myself, an exhibition of work produced in three Bay Area art centers that support artists with disabilities, Creativity Explored, Creative Growth, and the National Institute for Art and Disabilities. Create subsequently traveled nationally under the auspices of Independent Curators International. Larry was the founding director of the Wallace Institute for Contemporary Arts at the California College of the Arts, San Francisco and Oakland, where he also served as dean. Art Life, a collection of his essays, was published in 2005, and the Berkeley Art Museum and Pacific Film Archive will reopen in January of 2016 in a new home in downtown Berkeley designed by Dillis, Capito, and Renfro. Finally, myself, as Catherine said, I'm currently the director and chief curator of White Columns. I'm the co-curator of the current Judith Scott exhibition here. And over the past 12 years, I've presented the work of many artists associated with centers such as Creative Growth, the National Institute of Art and Disabilities, and New York's Healing Arts Initiative, amongst others, in both solo and group exhibitions at White Columns and in venues nationally and internationally. The title of tonight's discussion, Insider Art, Recent Curatorial Approaches to Self-Tour Art, simply reflects the unprecedented interest from both artists, curators of contemporary art, and institutions in the work of self-taught and so-called outsider artists over the past decade. And it also acknowledges the significant number of exhibitions and curatorial initiatives in the past decade that have sought to contextualize the work of self-taught and outsider artists alongside other forms of contemporary art. Tonight's panelists have all engaged critically with this expansive and expanding field in their own research and curatorial projects for many years, seeking to establish new narratives between the work of self-taught artists and other forms of contemporary art. We've invited each of the guests to initially make a short introductory presentation to give a sense of their ongoing research and personal engagement with this increasingly expansive field, after which time I'll propose a series of questions to the panel before we open up the conversation to include tonight's audience. And this event is being live streamed, so when we come to questions from the audience, please wait for the microphone to appear. So I'd like to invite first Lynne, then Larry, and finally Massimiliano to briefly introduce themselves. So welcome.
Thank you, Matthew. Matthew asked us to bring five images and to speak for 5 minutes. So I thought I would start with a quick accounting of key ideas in the Rosemary Trockel show that, as Matthew said, was at the New Museum 2 years ago, I think. And it was called A Cosmos. The idea was this would somehow conjure Rosemary Trockel's imaginary, the things that were of key interest to her and that could be linked to ongoing preoccupations, whether they had to do with feminism, feminist practices, or to do with natural histories, or with creative expression of various kinds. And we worked by selecting things in discussion, and they range very widely. And you can see here three cases on one of the floors that include, in the near case, some of Rosemary Trockel's work, and work by James Castle with those on the shelves in a kind of shooter's gallery lineup. In the second vitrine, there's work by Morton Bartlett, the ballerina, and some photographs, again, juxtaposed with some of Rosemary's work. And then upstairs, there was a whole section devoted to works of wool. Rosemary probably made her name internationally for a series of industrially knitted paintings. But these are later works in which wool has been stretched across the surface of canvases and stapled to make monochromes with a kind of drawn surface. And as we were developing this show, I had shown her reproductions of work by Judith Scott, and she was very keen to bring her work in juxtaposition with Judith Scott's, and there are many reasons for this, and a lot of them have to do with attitudes to craft, to the hierarchies in the academy between fine art and craft, to the association of craft-based activities, particularly working with textiles, to do with women and domesticity, and a certain kind of play with the idea of drawing, and drawing within both painting and sculpture. And so you can see they were put in juxtaposition in the way that one would in any normal group exhibition, without extended labels, without any kind of special biographical notation for Scott or for the natural history objects or for some of the scientific models. Everything was simply treated with the standard conventions of a contemporary art exhibition. When Matthew and Catherine invited me to contribute to the Judith Scott catalogue, I wrote a review of an exhibition in which Judith Scott's work was juxtaposed in a group show that had to do with abstract sculpture with artists who were working contemporaneously. Franz West, Judith Scott, Jessica Stockholder, and Rosemary Trockel, all of whom were working about on the same scale, and all of whose work in some way looked at the domestically scaled objects, or objects as they might be part of our domestic arena. And the exhibition was about how objects become things. Things that we live with, how things impact our lives, what is the nature of our ongoing relationship with things around us that we see and don't see on an ongoing basis. And the works all had, as I said, similar formal qualities, though each was singular in terms that they were recognizably the product of one maker of another. And the show had a very clear thesis, and it was an exhibition where the thesis set up the relationships between the works rather than any reference back to the maker. And by the maker, I mean biography or past histories or maker's intentions. The show had a certain kind of resolution within itself. I think we've heard in the last decades a great deal about the death of the author and the way in which the spectator completes the meaning or projects and finds meaning in works of art, but the work of art does not have a fixed content. The content comes into play through the interaction of spectator and work. And if there's a death of an author, I think there could be a death of a curator, where the curator steps back and the works set up the relationships between themselves rather than a thesis being projected on top of them. And so there is something common between the two shows that I'm describing in the way in which artists' intentions, curators' intentions are not the guiding model. And the last point I want to make is that in recent years, and particularly with Massimiliano's show in Venice, we've heard a lot about getting rid of labels, classificatory terms, like outsider, folk, vernacular, and so forth, and establishing an open playing field. And I think there's much to be said for this, but it's not, in my opinion, simply a question of widening the goalposts. A allowing more in, because widening the goalpost doesn't change the central relationship of what the margins have to the center. The center remains defined in the same terms as always. It's just the periphery is more popular, more populated. And what we need, I think, is a redefinition of those relationships where margins can become, in Bell Hooks' terms, sites of resistance, where artists might choose to work from the so-called periphery as a place to contend with some of what's contained in the center. So I think that it's possible to rethink these relationships if we take it case by case, rather than simply arguing for a dissolution of boundaries and categories willy-nilly.
Thanks, Larry.
Okay, so I have 10 slides, but I will talk for 5 minutes. The show that I'm going to talk about is the one that Matthew referred to at the beginning of his introduction. It's a show called Create, which Matthew and I organized together, that brought together the work of 20 artists who were participants in the studios at Creativity Explored, Creative Growth, and the National Institute for Arts and Disabilities, which are all centered in the San Francisco Bay Area. So the initial inspiration for this exhibition was the observation that there was an extraordinary amount of very strong and wonderful work coming out of these three studios. Specific artists that I had been following over a number of years, Matthew also becoming involved specifically with Creative Growth, which is in Oakland, Creativity Explored is in San Francisco, and NIAID is in Richmond, all within a few miles of each other. But these centers, which all three of which had been founded by the same couple, Florence and Elias Katz, in the 1970s and 80s, based on the same principles, had never, once they were founded, had much to do with each other. And I started to become intrigued by the question of why was there so much wonderful work coming out of these three art centers, and was there something that they had in common, some kind of methodology that was bringing forth such wonderful art. And so the exhibition served two functions, at least, primary functions. One, to foreground the work of 20 extraordinary artists, roughly divided among the three centers. And secondarily, primarily through the catalog and the public programs, to explore this history of the three centers and the methodology that was proposed by Florence and Elias Katz, which, summarized very quickly, had to do with giving adult artists with developmental disabilities an opportunity to work in communal studios at hours which reflected the common work hours, 5 days a week, 9 to 5, that these centers be connected to the art world, that there be a gallery connected to the studio, that there be not teachers, but facilitators who would assist the artists in making their work, and that there would be a sales element. It's interesting that the first of these centers was created right almost exactly at the same moment of Roger Cardinal's famous outsider art definition about outsider artists being cut off from the world, and these centers were radically connected to the world. So I'll just run very quickly through the work of several of the artists who were involved. Evelyn Reyes, who is with Creativity Explored in San Francisco, pastel. These are a representative image. They're carrots. John Patrick McKenzie, here using a found surface, a Felix Gonzalez Torres print on which he has written a poem about the seasons. Bertha Otoya, a wonderful printmaker who also includes a text element in her work. Ori Ramirez, wonderful artist from Creative Growth in Oakland. Carl Hendrickson, who is paraplegic, who works with the facilitators at Creative Growth to make these wonderful minimal sculptures. Marlon Mullen, his seemingly abstract paintings like this one are all based on images he finds in magazines and newspapers. And Jeremy Burleson from NIAID, and he has two related bodies of work, one of which is sculptures that are based on medical equipment. This is an oxygen ventilator. He has another series of restraint devices, handcuffs and things of that kind. And then actually a third body of work, which are these lanterns that hang from the ceiling. So this was an installation shot of Jeremy Burleson's work in Create. This is the Studio of Creativity Explored, Lance Rivers, another one of the artists in the show, and I was very interested in at the time and continue to be the particular ecology of the studios at these three centers, which are very wonderful. And in fact, a subsequent exhibition that I worked on with David Wilson, a San Francisco-based artist, took the model of these three art centers and extrapolated it into another exhibition called The Possible, where we brought in weavers, ceramic artists, printmakers from around the world to work in studios that we built inside the museum, and that were in. So we basically turned the museum for the period of 4 months into a kind of a collaborative studio, and included in amongst the artists who were involved in this were the artists from Creative Growth, and you can see some of their art hanging from the ceiling there. At the end of the exhibition, there was a fashion show where it was a collaboration between artists from Creative Growth and others, and it was wonderful.
Thanks, Larry. Massimiliano.
Hello, everybody. I don't have a watch, so I'm going to look at my cell phone to understand if I'm running out of time, so I'm not checking my email. It's great to be here tonight. Also with Lynne, we've been on, I think, at this point, six panels or seven panels together on the question of the insider and the outsider. And in the first part of my career, I sat on panels about biennials, and now I seem to sit only on panels about the insider and outsider. And I start thinking of a funny joke about the madman in the hospital that is locked inside his room, and he starts banging on the door of his cell and calls for the doctors and calls for the nurse, and then looks through the little window and say, "Are you crazy? You locked yourself inside." I think, irony aside, that is one of the crucial problems or questions that fascinates at least me in the question of the inside and the outside. Another way to say it would be to quote Michel Foucault, who famously said that psychology can never tell the truth about madness because it is madness that holds the truth about psychology. I think in the questioning of the inside and outside, we are bound to learn something about the borders and categories that hold what we call contemporary art in place, and I think that at least explains my fascination with that question. Not so much in broadening the gates for the barbarians to come in, but more in understanding what are the categories and what are the foundations and the walls that hold in place what we call contemporary art, in the hope possibly of changing the shape of those walls. I think also that the question of the insider and the outsider reveals many of the myths and fears and aspirations that move contemporary art, particularly in these last few years. I think that one myth that we've been searching in the question of insider and outsider art is the question of authenticity and the question of innocence, and I think it is quite revealing that an art system that is more and more invested in the market and more preoccupied with values and so on looks at the question of the outsider as a sort of mythical creature that can help us regain our innocence. In one of Fishley and Weiss' wonderful questions, they ask themselves, "Can I regain my innocence?" And I think that is ultimately one of the questions that leads this attraction towards the outsider, or anyway, that I myself also keep going back to. Can I look at art with an innocent gaze? And whether or not that is a conservative question, maybe that's something that we should discuss further on. I have a few images, but they're not so prevalent anyway. They're mostly images from the Venice Biennale, which was called the Encyclopedic Palace, which is this object you see back here, which was, I don't even know if it was an artwork or not, it was an object built by Marino Auriti, and it was a model for a museum that would contain the entire knowledge of the world. And the exhibition itself more or less dealt with similar feats of omniscience and the attempt of organizing knowledge through images and the attempt of knowing everything. This was the other starting point of the exhibition, which was Carl Gustav Jung's Red Book. I show these two images because I think they also help clarify my position towards the question of the inside and the outside, and that is, first of all, not to fetishize the disabled, not to fetishize the outsider as somebody being sick. I wanted to start this biennial on one hand with Auriti, who was not recognized as an artist, who thought of himself as an artist, and on the other hand as Carl Gustav Jung, again, somebody who we don't think of as an artist. We certainly don't think of him as a patient. If anything, we think of him as a doctor. And I think in that juxtaposition, I wanted to stress that I was less interested in the outside as the deviant or the diseased or the patient, and more as different forms of dilettantism and different forms of amateurs. I think more than the term outsider, I'm interested in the question of the amateur, in the question of the dilettante, in the question of people who make images either as acts of love or as ways to spend their time. And I think if you look at from that perspective, the distinction between the professional and the non-professional starts blurring even further. Some of the motivation that have driven my interest towards outsider art or towards less canonical artworks have to do also with, in a way, with the question of the artwork. I think of shows, particularly like the Venice Biennials and other shows I put together, less as exhibitions of artworks and more as exhibitions of images. On many levels, images are at the same time too important, I think, to be left to artists alone. We all make images, we all make images of different intensities, and I think images are a matter of life and death, and that is a question that not only artists should be left with dealing with. On the other hand, I think we live in a society that is more and more based on images, and in which artists paradoxically have less and less of a say. Most of the images we deal with are commercial. They mostly images that invite you to spend money or to do something, and I think it's important to ask ourselves again why we make images as humans and what is the position of images within ourselves and within our culture. The second reason or motivation behind my fascination with less canonical work of art is, in fact, to try to question the canon or do away with the very notion of the canon. And I think, again, if we broaden our spectrum and we look beyond the definitions of art, I think very interesting things start happening. The reason of I'm interested in questioning the canon is not just because I have also delusions of grandeur and I want to rethink the history of art, but because also, quite frighteningly, today I think hierarchies are established in the name of the market, and the good and bad are simply functions of prices, and I think it's more interesting to start looking into the cracks of that canon to discover different definitions of art, and so to be less interested in the masterpiece as a sort of burden that forces onto the viewer a specific form of respect, and instead think of art objects as different forms of minor art that towards which we can have more complex relationships. I think those are maybe two of the main reasons why I'm fascinated. And third, probably, is the matter of doing away with taste. Taste, again, is unfortunately often a accomplishment. accomplice of powers, and so I think many artists, particularly who curate shows, and many of the inspiration for my shows come from artists curated shows, and I think artists curated shows demonstrate ways of combining art and non-art, which fortunately teach us to go beyond taste and rethink categories that are often accepted. I think those are some of the points that in that I wanted to raise.
Okay. Thanks, everybody. That was great. I guess just you know, touching on things that all of you have mentioned, but. You know, Massimiliano, you talked about looking into what you call the cracks, and Lynne, you referred to this idea of the periphery. And I guess over the past decade, it's really apparent that the work of so-called outsider artists has become presented alongside other forms of contemporary art in exhibitions at galleries, museums, biennials, to a degree which I think is unprecedented. You know, thinking broadly, I mean, how might we explain this degree of interest in this kind of work, and what's to be learned from such curatorial juxtapositions? I think, you know, it's especially interesting too in relation to, you know, what Massimiliano, you mentioned about the market, the current situation we find ourselves in relation to the economics in the art world. And how do all of these things coalesce in this interest in this space between work that historically had been marginalized and is now more than welcome in the curatorial narrative, at least, and if any of you want to pick up.
Well, I think some of the comments that were made in the first introduction are very true in terms of the art historical threads that have made this possible, and feminism and other kinds of radical art history have certainly opened up the discourse, generally the art historical discourse, to be open to non-canonical works, and I think that is a welcome and ongoing project. And I personally don't see my engagement with practices like these or artists like these as one of center versus periphery. I really don't find it useful to distinguish, and it's just instinctively not my temperament to do so. I see, in fact, artists such as these on the same playing field, very much so, as any other artist in my community. Another thing, though, regarding the market, the category of outsider art, I think, has probably been promulgated primarily because of its value as a marketing device. And one can wring one's hands about that, but for the time that it happened, and I do hope its time will pass at some point in not too distant future, it served a very important function of bringing work that otherwise would have taken longer to be seen, probably, into public view. So I wouldn't say that the market should be ashamed for having invented this category. It was useful to create, people made money off of it, but it also served to draw a circle around something that would otherwise have been relatively invisible.
I agree, it probably is unprecedented in terms of quantity in recent years, but it's certainly not the first wave of enthusiasm, and the 70s is a moment where you see a great outpouring of interest and all these discoveries, let's say, of self-taught work the South and the Appalachians, all over the country, and often from artists who were in the region. So there was a kind of pushback in some senses, whether in Chicago or Philadelphia or elsewhere, from artists who did not buy into the dominant narratives of New York and were looking to propose alternatives. But I think what happened in the 70s, and unfortunately is happening again now, these questions of authenticity and innocence that the so-called creator who's not part of the academic art training system and therefore not, and subsequently not part of the inner echelons of the art world, the authenticity and innocence are connected to some notion that this is pouring out of some form of inner expression. And I think that that's absolutely untenable. When you look closely at the work of someone like James Castle, it's very clear he's making in response to an extraordinary wealth of images and memory of the places he lived. He's constructing a world based on the world around him, and he's using images from advertising and from mail order catalogs and the like. And this is true of many artists. They're not isolated in the sense that they're cut off from culture. They participate in culture very strongly. And the authenticity is not about some notion of the romantic genius cut off in this separate zone. And I think we see too much of that again. And what makes this work interesting to, or can make this work interesting, is how it inflects with work that's being made by concurrently, and how it helps us think through some of the issues that professional artists are addressing now.
I just wanted to add something about the market, because I was actually reading the other day on the Christie's website that they were somehow marketing outside of art as a new hot commodity, and I was, of course, referred to as the initiator of that trend, so I guess I'm also complicit with that. But I think the question for me is, obviously it's always the question of assimilation, but the question is, how can some of these objects, and not necessarily just the objects made by outsider artists, but how can we preserve their status as foreigners and as strange or as strangers? I think that to me is a question as a curator, that it's not just a matter of assimilating certain type of works and proclaiming them as important as, let's say, the central canonical works. So it's not a matter of saying Henry Darger is as important as other masters of contemporary art, but it's how both the work of outsiders or the works from different provenances, including contemporary art, can still maintain a critical power that disrupts categories. And I think that's also a question: how do you let that happen when you're installing the show? How you retain the artwork's power to be disrupted in a certain manner? And I mean, I don't have an answer for that, but I think that is the question: that it's not a matter of assimilation, it's not a matter of making the outsider artist look canonical, but letting artworks be non-canonical all the time, or letting artworks be disrupted.
I mean, for me, this is what all art should be, disruptive, and I don't personally see the value in distinguishing or maintaining a difference in one's expectations about what art made by people who have certain conditions versus people who have other conditions. I think that maintaining the strangeness, all art should be made strange, or its strangeness should be preserved, not just art made by people who come from a disability.
I'd just like to pick up on something you mentioned in your introduction, Massimiliano, about the interest in this field or this kind of work from artists, and that also folded into something you just mentioned, Lynne, which is about how artists in places like Chicago, late 60s and 70s, or people in Philadelphia, i.e. not the main metropolitan centers far at that time, did pick up on this work. And I think, you know, especially a lot of my interest in this work was informed by, say, Jim Shirley's collection of thrift store paintings, or Mike Kelly's interest in the work of adolescents, or even Jeremy Deller in the UK's collecting contemporary British folk art. I mean, they seem to me open up new ways to address some of the questions about the disruptive object and how you like to maintain that. But it seems to me a lot of the interest curatorial in the last decade has probably been informed by artists' interest, whether it's Rudolf Trockel's or Mike Kelly's and so on.
I mean, first of all, going back also to the fortune of outsider art within the 20th century, it is, particularly in the first half, it's largely a history written by artists, not Dubuffet, and obviously the surrealists before, and not always without problems, because, I mean, it's also a history of assimilation, it's a history of artists thinking of themselves as capable of just claiming the product of other people, as, if not as their own, as meaningful artworks. So it is also a history of, particularly when it comes to the surrealist, of a form of assimilation, if you will, a form of even colonialism, not that you appropriate the work of the outsider artist with a freedom and a carelessness that you wouldn't have when it comes probably to the work of an insider artist. So I think that's, and I don't know if that's something you are researching in your exhibition, but it is sort of a history that goes throughout the 20th century of the artist assimilating or using the work of the so-called outsider, and it's not always an innocent story. Having said that, I think, yes, I don't have an answer about why curators are more and more attracted by artist curated shows. I think certainly throughout the 90s, at least for me, it was a revelatory experience to encounter Jim Shaw and Mike Kelly and all that. But it's also, again, within the history of art, there is an entire tradition that thinks of art as a subcategory of images or of cultural studies. And I think that's also where my personal interests come from, to understand that we should think of art in a wider context, that it's not just a sort of self-reflexing masterpiece. I think that is the problem that I have most problems with, because the more you go to the museums, the more we have an accepted notion of what an artwork is that I think more and more people are uncomfortable with.
I think, Lynne, you know, in your introductory comments, you know, you a lot of I think everyone's comments is around terminology, because, you know, I think we all understand that the term outsider art is clearly a very imprecise term. I think it's a very useful term in sort of just giving us an idea of something that is different from whatever it's different to. But it's clear that the term outsider art embraces very diverse approaches to creative production, so that the term's been applied to the work of artists with disabilities, self-taught artists of all kinds, so-called visionary art, as well as many forms of vernacular art, including folk art. So it seems to me that the term in this sort of ridiculous embrace is not so useful. And its lack of precision. And I was just thinking that, you know, going forward, I mean, how useful is Roger Cardinal's term from 1972, as Larry mentioned, around the same time the centers were founded in the Bay Area? So, I mean, how useful is his term, given the complexities of an individual artist's motivations, intentions, and circumstances? And how, going forward, might we establish more precise, perhaps even useful, terminology in relation to this field?
Well, as you say, Matthew, outsider art meant one thing in 1972, and it was the English language covenant for Dubuffet's term of art group. And he meant by that mystics, visionaries, and people in insane asylums who he categorized as asocial, if not antisocial. That simply just doesn't apply to most people making art. In fact, for many people making art with disabilities, there's an enormous drive to encourage them to self-identify as artists. They are not somewhere apart, they're actually moving forward into art worlds. The impetus is very much about being part of an art world. So there seems to me there's no way in which that original definition has much currency. But so the term has then been so expanded as to be in some ways completely useless, I think. It's not easy to find an alternative that would in any way encompass all these categories, and I don't think it's worth trying. But I'm not sure what the categories are, because what's the difference now? We're talking about not domesticating this work, maintaining its sense of strangeness, allowing it to disrupt the canonical. But in large part, if you see one of these works, whether it's a drawing by James Castle or one of Judith Scott's work in a museum installation, you wouldn't know by looking at it, the biography of the artist. And if we can't tell by looking, what are we drawing on that's saying this is different and apart? And if our only resource is biography, then I think we have a huge problem, because we use biography to be symptomatic. So this person has these issues, and look, here's the work, as if the work greatest consequence of these biographical facts. And that is simply not the case. It's not true in terms of people with mental disabilities that there's some symptomatology that references different mental states. That's completely disproven. And mostly, a great deal of work made by professional artists looks very similar. And if we can't, as I said, to go back to this point, if we can't tell visually the difference, on what terms are we making a distinction?
Yeah, which though should be an argument for treating all visual culture in the same way. I think that's to me what, why don't we go to museums and have castle, but also cartoons, and also, I think, I mean, paradoxically, an interesting way would be to think of all the artworks or all the visual manifestations as symptoms of our culture, and to try to decrypt them to understand something about ourselves. So, you know, Warburg thought of himself as a psychohistorian. I don't know what he exactly meant, but what he meant was that you could learn something about art, not only by looking at art history, but by looking at advertisement, by looking at the art of the alienated, as it was called at that time. So I think that is, for me, the key. Can we think of institutions, and it's significant that we use the same word for museums and hospitals, can we think of institutions as places where different kinds of visual manifestations are included, and wouldn't that let us understand better ourselves? So that is why I personally welcome the influx of outsider art along with other manifestations of visual culture.
So I agree with Massimiliano that this type of institution he's proposing, which you've embodied in your exhibitions very successfully, is a very exciting direction. But within this kind of multiverse that embraces different kinds of visual culture, I would still, as a curator, like to have the capacity or the responsibility of skewing towards images that, even if they aren't art, are, let's say, artistic, that have a strangeness, even if they weren't made as art. And maybe that's a kind of curatorial colonialism, I'm not sure. But if one gives up entirely the idea that there are certain things that have some kind of special something, then it in not adept hands, could become just boring. I mean, when you welcome everything, and you do a great job at choosing things that are wonderful and strange. In response to your question about outsider art, I do think from a curatorial perspective and an art historical perspective, it is a term that has outlived its usefulness. In terms of, you know, what shall we call these things, I think the only reason to bring forth a category, from my perspective as a curator, is if it serves the purpose of the art and making, or let's say the artistic, and making some kind of experience that has something I would consider, you know, having an artistic quality, more available to a viewer. So I wouldn't say categorically, I don't want to have any categories that distinguish certain types of art from another. I could imagine an instance where one might want to define with language or by a selection in a certain exhibition certain types of things in order to draw out some quality, some shared quality that would not otherwise be visible. At this point, I think it is nothing but a kind of a lingering social prejudice to draw that circle around art made by people with disabilities.
You know, bring this back to this question about, because something myself and Catherine, when we were making the exhibition upstairs, you know, very keenly aware and conscious of, you know, how much about Judith Scott's, I mean, the extraordinary story is brought to bear in the exhibition itself. You know, should we mention that this was a deaf, new woman with Down syndrome? To what extent should that narrative become implicated in the actual exhibition itself? And I think, you know, it remains unresolved, but I think certainly we've become or we gravitate to these narratives as it relates to artists who perhaps didn't have a voice or didn't externalize their voice during their lifetime. So I think it's very unusual for us to learn about a contemporary artist's private life unless they've been profiled by Calvin Tompkins in The New Yorker, when all of a sudden we learn a lot. Yet we remain fascinated by the life of self-taught outsider artists, whether it's Dodge or James Castle or Judith Scott. But I wanted to fold that back into, you know, your point you made, Lynne, about James Castle, is that he was constructing a world from his world. And how useful is the knowledge of that world when we're left with the work? I mean, as you said, when we walk into a gallery, it's not clear when we see a James Castle, this is the work of a man with, you know, whatever issues he had during his lifetime. But the biographical narrative is implicated in the work.
I think it's a question partly of when you get to the biographical narrative. If it's up front and center, you walk into a show and it says, Artist X had these issues. Well, from that moment on, everything you look at and think about will be filtered through that. And I think there's a distinction to be made between work that's determined by these issues and work that's informed by these issues. And I think in every case I know of, the work may be informed in some ways by limitations, but limitations can be of access to technical facilities or materials. Artists of all kinds have limitations that inform their practices. Cameras of a certain kind were available, they couldn't afford something or other. It becomes a factor in the making of the work, but we don't see it as determining the work and providing these parentheses within which the work is created. And I think that this sense of timing, maybe by the time you leave the Judith Scott show, it would be useful to know something of this biographical data. But I don't think it's necessary. I don't think one needs to start with it, and I'm not sure when you actually need to know it, if at all. I guess why I was talking about group shows is because I would say there's much less need, because it's not about tracing the evolution of a practice, it's not about mining an imaginary as such.
But in a solo show like this, which is a kind of a retrospective or a survey show, it's perfectly appropriate to talk about something like this. Any retrospective or survey show will generally in the wall labels talk about certain biographical facts about the artist. It's not unusual at all.
But when would, say, Jackson Pollock's problems with alcohol and his psychoanalytical sessions, when would they come up? First line? Maybe when you get to...
They still come up a lot in an official evidence.
In some kind of heroicizing myth-making, but generally speaking, that wouldn't be what you lead with.
I'm not saying you should lead with it, but I don't think we should be shy of it either. I mean, I think biography is interesting if it illuminates the art, but I don't think we should shy away from it. And I think we're on the cusp of a period, thank goodness for it, where we can talk about these things openly without it overly determining our the way we experience the art, or sort of shunting our experience into a predetermined place. Where it is outside or somehow covered in a veil of weirdness that it doesn't ever ask for and maybe doesn't deserve.
And I think one thing we tried to do in this exhibition was to underscore Judith Scott's history with creative growth, because it's unlikely these objects would have been made if she hadn't encountered creative growth. So it's trying to articulate the narrative that the relationship between an individual and institution, how that juxtaposition allowed these things to evolve. But
I have the first of all, I thought it was quite perfectly handled in the exhibition, the biographical data, and I could tell somehow there's been a lot of questioning and thinking behind those decisions. And those are also decisions that, as I was working on the Massimiliano, I asked myself hundreds of times, because in general, first of all, I like exhibitions to be quite verbose and full of words, because I also think that again, the sort of stupor that people have in front of artworks in typical contemporary art museums is problematic. I think sometimes we do actually need the biography. We do need an excess of words to steer away the attention from the viewer that otherwise would just be passively receiving the artwork as a manifestation of beauty and often as a manifestation of the power of the institution itself. So I think for me, maybe because I'm Italian and you know Vasari wrote The Lives of Artists, I think the biographical touches help waking up the attention of the viewer that otherwise just stares at the Picasso for its presumed beauty and most often for its hidden price. I think that's that is a bigger problem. Not do we go to the museums just to stare with our mouth open and say, oh, that's beautiful, or we go to learn something more about ourselves and about the stories behind these objects. You know, I think for me, ultimately, and this is an example that unfortunately Lynne has heard over and over because I use it all the time, I think we have much more complex ideas of museums, for example, here at the Brooklyn Museum or the Metropolitan Museum, when we step into galleries of Egyptian art or Greek art or even medieval art, where our knowledge and our assumptions about what art is are much more complicated and porous. And then when we get to the contemporary art galleries, our understanding of what museums should do and what artworks are mostly very conservative. Artworks are pretty pictures on the wall, in front of which we have to open our mouth in a state of stupidity and admiration. And I think sometimes those biographical elements help us wake up from that and understand that those objects are more complicated. They have a history, they have a story, they have a biography behind them.
Can I just
Sure.
I don't mean to criticize the show. What I would say that for me was very important was the emphasis on the Center for Creative Growth. Not only because had Judith Scott not gone there, it's highly improbable she would have made this work, but for the way in which it set up an art-making studio, and it functioned like a studio, and there's a gallery adjacent to it, and there's people making work in very different kinds. But it functions like any studio situation that a student would have gone through in an art school or any other kind. So in other words, she's going through, she's placed in relation to art-making situations, which are absolutely standard and normal. This is what we understand by learning experiences to make art. And I think that's a very, I've not seen that done before, and I think it's a really important contribution.
Yeah, I want to point out that if only this was normal, this studio situation, I think there would be a lot more great art in the world because it's a very fantastic model. And it's actually unlike an art school on the one hand or like a solitary artist studio on the other. It's communal, so the artists are together, artists working in many different disciplines side by side with access to tools and materials. But Matthew, when we were working on the show together, pointed out another very important difference between these studios, which are not schools, there's no instruction, a difference between them and schools, which is that the artists never have to leave. There is a tremendous pressure when you're in school to produce something and then get graded on it. Judith Scott, the first year she was there, didn't do anything. She sat there and I don't know what she thought she was doing or what the people there thought she would ever do. But it took a very long time for her to get her act together and start making art. And some artists are in these centers have been there for 30 years, 40 years. And I think, you know, in reflecting on these centers through the work I did on the show with Matthew, I think that this model, the space where you're with other people and you never have to leave, should look into that.
I should also say, I didn't do very much at art school during my first year.
There you go.
I'm going to just bring one last sort of area of thought up to the panel, and then hopefully we'll open it up to questions from the audience, because I'm sure there should be lots. And really, the final thing I was sort of interested to talk about this point in the evening is, you know, as curators of contemporary art, you know, A, do we have responsibilities, whatever they might be, ethical, moral, etc., in relation to the objects we present and contextualize? And if that's the case, do these responsibilities change or shift when the artist who made the work isn't able to communicate their intentions? For example, perhaps the artist is no longer alive, they left no record, or the artist doesn't have access to kind of conventional forms of communication, such as the case of Judith Scott. So it's really a question about, you know, the responsibilities we have as curators to objects, and then in this different category of objects, do those responsibilities shift or change?
This goes back to my days as an art student. I think I'm conflicted between being interested in art history as a social history of art, and also what the German-speaking world used to call pure visibility, now the belief that you can look and understand and write a history of art by simply looking at the objects, which is based on the assumption that the artist is dead, whether or not he or she is alive, and the object is a self-contained universe that contains all its meanings in itself, with or without the artist. So I can say I stand somewhere in between, that I do believe we need to approach these works as though the artists were dead. And I think paradoxically, in the case of outsider art, we are even allowed to do that more freely than when you have a gallery from Chelsea telling you how to end the show. I think that's there are more spaces of freedom sometimes. You obviously have to be, as a reader, conscious of your horizon of expectations, I think. No? You need to be a reader that reads what is in the text and not comes ideas that are imposed on the text. So I think that is possible, not to look at these objects as though they were somehow without their fathers and mothers and still inscribe them within the history of culture. But I guess that's, you know, a matter of responsibility, whether or not the artist is an outsider. I think it's a matter of responsibility all the time.
Yeah, I agree, and I would just say in relation to artist's intent, it's maybe less a question of curatorial responsibility as curatorial opportunity, that when there is an artist who is available to express their intent, it just adds another opportunity for a curator to have access to that, you know, that facet of the work's being, and perhaps to foreground it, because art objects don't always, in fact, probably rarely end at the edges of the object. The artist who made them often, I think, has some idea of how they should be presented and what world they should live in, and, you know. And I think that it is certainly valuable and, an opportunity for curators to take that into account. But I don't think that that is the only way for works to be shown. I do think that once a work is born, it enters into a world of free things, and curators have an opportunity and a right, I guess, to recontextualize, but just need to do that with a sense of respect.
I think curators have a variety of different kinds of responsibility in different kinds of shows. If you're working on a retrospective with a living artist, you, I think, enter into some kind of contract based on trust and mutual willingness to support the work to bring it to a certain conclusion. If the artist is not alive, you have a different kind of responsibility. With works in a group show, whether the artist is alive or not, I think the intention or the desires that the artist expressed or not are less relevant than the dynamic of the group show, let's say. I think you always have a responsibility to the material artifact of the object, not to present two parts and not the third because it didn't fit or something like that. So there are a whole range of things. But I think there are also types, there are shows that are relevant historically and become inappropriate in some senses at another historical moment, and there's a responsibility around that. And I'm thinking about there are a lot of artists who would not want to have their work in a show put under a national banner, you know, a show of French art. There are a lot of women who do not see any need now for shows devoted to women's art. There might have been in the 60s, but the dynamic has changed, and what was a spearhead has become a ghetto, in those terms, and we could extend that. And I think we might make some of those arguments in this arena with the self-taught as well.
So I guess one of the, you know, the reasons this thought came up with me and when myself and Catherine were organizing this exhibition is that because Judith Scott had no verbal or written communication, there's no understanding of which way is the correct orientation for any of these objects. So there's no up, down, there's no bottom or top. So they consequently have been presented in really wildly different ways. So when they were presented in London, the Museum of Everything, they were suspended on fishing wire. And at the Brooklyn Museum, we present them on these low platforms, which is relatively close to how the works were made when she worked at the tabletop in the studio in Brooklyn. I think we'd like to open it up to questions from the audience, and we really hope there are questions either for an individual or to the general subject, and we'll do our best to answer them. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and someone will bring along a microphone. Down here in the front.
Thank you. That was really very informative and wonderful. Thinking about art fairs and the fact that the Outsider Fair is now going on and Armory opens next week, do you see art fairs incorporating outsider art into their curatorial acceptance, their committee meeting vetting as a next step, as a next logical step in merging, bringing outside or inside?
Well, I think Massimiliano's part of it.
No, just for this, I love my profession, not very much, but enough to say that fairs are not curatorial project, so I would not use that adjective in relation to anything that has to do with our fairs.
But I think, you know, with the Outsider Art Fair just closed in New York, Andrew Edlin, who runs that, in the audience, and certainly I think a fair like Frieze Masters in London has opened up territory within the Frieze brand of art fairs to basically include anything. And so I think, you know, some things are changing. Some it's porous. And, you know, I think this year at the Outsider Art Fair, Anne Duran and Jay Gorney, curators and critics of contemporary art, curated an exhibition that occupied one of the spaces within the Outsider Art Fair. So I think there's definitely a different, more porous relationship between what goes into what is considered to be contemporary art fair.
Yeah, I don't know much about art fairs or the market, but I think it's inevitable that artists like the artists that were in the Create Show will find themselves increasingly in mainstream galleries, and they'll show in whatever art fairs those galleries happen to be in.
You know, and I think one of the intentions of the founders of Creative Growth and Creativity Explored the Cats was to create economic narratives for those artists. So they were very interested, even before the centers opened, that the artists would benefit from their creative labors. And I guess where some of that economy now exists is within the larger narrative of art fairs. Other questions? Yep, to the side here.
Thank you so much for your comments. I'm wondering, when you are meeting with an artist or a group of artists to exhibit their work, how do you determine what sort of writing they would like in an exhibit about their work? Like, what sorts of questions do you ask? What kinds of conversations do you have, especially if it's a lesser known artist?
Worth an entire other panel. No, I think that to bring it to this panel, I think what your question raises is, first of all, the question of the intention of the artist. Am I, as a curator, responsible to the presumed intention of the artist? I think, you know, if you look at literary criticism, there's been 30, 40 years in which the role of the author has been defined and analyzed in much more complicated terms. When it comes to art, often the assumption that many artists have is that you sit down and you listen, take notes, tell the truth, send the text back to the artist, get the artist to revise it and send it back to you. And I think that's the death of curating, the death of criticism, the death of many of the excitement of interpretation that I think makes up the art world or art as I like it at least. So I don't think there is an answer on how you go about that. I think it's also a matter of contracts and expectations within individuals and also within institutions. There are artists who firmly want to control the reception and description of their work. There are others that are more open.
And Lynne, when you mentioned the exhibition you made with Rosemary Trockler, Cosmos, I mean, you sort of alluded that it was a collaborative dialogue between you and the artist that brought new material into the exhibition that perhaps Trockler wasn't so familiar with, or she brought material into the thing that was very important to her. So is that part of this question, this dialogue?
That's probably an unusual exhibition in the sense of the back and forth, also because there's so much that was not hers. But I think in general you can say as a curator you're between the artist and the institution, so you're protecting the artist from the institution, but you're standing for the institution in relation to the artist, so you go back and forth depending on which way the pressure's coming in order to make this come to some resolution. The institution has its needs too, which are very legitimate in relation to its public, health and safety, all those kinds of things. But the artist too has obviously legitimate needs, so that's how you kind of bring them into a relation that's key.
In regard to the CREATE exhibition, our approach for the 20 artists was to have a novelist, Kevin Killian, write all of the entry texts in the catalog for each of those three artists. So he was coming from a perspective that was not art historical. He didn't do studio visits, but he's a very close-looking, thoughtful person who was able to look at these the images and the objects and make connections to other artworks, to things in visual culture and culture generally. And it was really clearly presented as, you know, one person's perspective. I personally am very interested in what artists think about their work, and unless I have a good reason not to, I'd be inclined to represent that in how I describe the work to others.
And, you know, certainly my experience of collaborating for 12 years with the artists at Creative Growth and with the staff at Creative Growth and centers like that, it's just extraordinarily complicated because the majority of the artists, because of the nature of their disability, don't have conventional forms of communication. They don't refer or relate their work to kind of conventional narratives of art history. And certainly I found that in each of my encounters with a different artist, it's almost like starting from scratch each time. So we have to learn almost like a new language in order for me not only to acclimatize to the things I'm looking at, but also to establish some relationship with the artist's intentions, which in the case of Judith Scott, you know, I was fortunate enough to meet, there was no communication. So there's a huge space sometimes between you and the work. Another question? Just a few.
I wanted to pick up on something that Lynne said in her introduction about reimagining the periphery and the center. And I was thinking if you could speak a little bit more about the periphery and the margin as sites of resistance. And actually, I think in some ways, Creative Growth maybe could be an example of that, as initially there's a label of outsider art or art made by people with disabilities, but then you can kind of imagine a different way of communal art making because of that. And what do you think of that? And are there other examples? Thanks.
Well, I think that the Center for Creative Growth and the other two institutions in the Bay Area are remarkable, and the many other institutions that have been based on them in Australia and the British Isles elsewhere, they've done remarkable work. I'm thinking in part of a case in point might be an artist called Forrest Bess, who showed at a very mainstream blue chip gallery, Betty Parsons, in the 40s and 50s, who did not move to New York from Texas, but lived his life as a bait fisherman in large part on a remote part of the Texas coastline, and whose relationship with the New York art world was kept at arm's length, and who developed a very complex philosophical system around, you probably know. And anyway, it was an elaborate system which was a worldview, which is embodied in his work, which was not actually included in the presentations of his work during his lifetime, but have subsequently been incorporated in, for example, Bob Gover's presentation of the biennial. So I would say in someone like Forrest Press, who'd been to art school, who was very familiar with, you know, the New York art world and the whole museum structure and all of that, that's choosing to be elsewhere as out of a position of strength, not because it couldn't have been otherwise. And I think increasingly we're seeing, whether it's geographic removal or distancing in other ways, refusal to get involved with certain kinds of structures within the art world. We could talk about David Hammond's when he moved to New York from the West Coast, how much work he made in Harlem, how much work was made that was fugitive, how much work that was made outside, certainly outside a market for a very long time. It's not in that case perhaps a case of geographical removal per se in terms of long distances, but it's about an attitude and value system.
Thanks, we have another question. Sorry, over in the middle, yeah.
The artists that we've discussed that have certain purity and integrity to their artwork, which is what has, you know, brought us to embrace it. Now that these artists over a period of time, as you've worked with them, are like intersecting with the marketplace, i.e. they are being paid or making money off work is being sold, how do you perceive that this has affected them? In other words, if they have done a particular sort of thing that has been more accepted or bought or purchased or they receive money for, do they tend to then go in that direction? I mean, how have they responded?
At these three centers, the gallery and sales in the gallery have been part of the model from the very beginning, from the early 1970s. The artists who work in these studios can see the gallery, they can see the visitors. Depending on their kind of disability, they know the work is being sold. Some of them make art that sells. They do get paid. They're just like anybody else who, you know, is excited when someone buys their work. They may be excited that they're getting money. So yes, there are things, trends if you can call them, or individual career paths that these artists take and follow in these three centers, depending on their degree of disability. There are some who are more aware than others of what is happening, but it's front and center and has been part of the model from the very beginning.
Thank you. I think what's interesting about outside art for me is just the pure creativity of people and the ability to just the will to create and make. I'd like to know what attracts you guys to this type of art personally. What do you get out of working with these types of artists? What kind of what they make or new materials? What do you personally get out from working in this area?
First of all, I'll be the devil's advocate. There is a very nice essay by Al Foster about the fascination of the surrealist for the outsider artist, and he basically claims that actually outsider art is far from being creative, is mostly repetitive, and he expresses a longing for order rather than a celebration of chaos. I don't remember, do you remember the title of the essay? It's, and I think that's also quite interesting for us to think about, that the certain manifestations of outsider art are, which now are described as obsessive, tend to be extremely formulaic, tend to be extremely built on repetitions of the visual formulas. And so for me, so it's not a matter of the myth of the liberated mad person that can do whatever or he or she wants. For me, the interest towards certain forms of less canonical or not recognized as artistic practices is that I think they tell us something about our culture and tell us something about ourselves that art itself cannot tell us. And that's the most simplistic way to describe it. If anything, because they tell us how humans use time and how humans use images, which I think is a peculiarity that distinguishes from animals. And so that's my personal interest.
Larry?
For me, there's just no difference at all between the art that I like that is made in these studios and art that I like that is made outside the studios. There's differences between individual works, but my attraction to these works has nothing to do with the fact that the artists are have developmental disabilities.
My start with the work was some work that's fascinating to me, and it's not, in the beginning it's irrelevant where it's coming from, but I think that, sorry, I was betraying myself, something you said, Massimiliano, it's not where this comes from, and I think that we look at many objects in an aesthetic perspective, and some days we can look at scientific models like the Blaschko's glass objects as works of art or within an aesthetic framework. That doesn't mean we think they're always works of art. We can look at them in histories of science. Well, these artifacts are very labile and they move into multiple categories. They're not fixed in one. And the other thing I would say is that we've talked tonight more or less exclusively about outsider artists, if you like, in relation to people with disabilities. But historically in this country, there are a great many other makers who were called outsiders who did not have mental disabilities. They had completely different kinds of profiles. They might have been poor, illiterate, living in a rural, relatively small rural communities. They had any number of other impediments to going to art school and following a normal artist career path, but they were not people with mental disabilities. So we've talked about one sector alone, and it has its own set of concerns, sure, which don't necessarily come up if we're talking about James Castle or we're talking about Sister Gertrude Morgan.
And certainly my interest curatorially, it is largely resides in the work of centers that support artists with disabilities. So the work that we've for the most part presented in the context of programs at White Columns is connected to artists who work at centers. And my encounter with Creative Growth in 2002 was the sort of trigger for that, because it struck me as a wholly radical place. And the genealogy of the organization, the motivation behind its founders, the way that the organization is run, just struck me as arguably the most radical art-making context I'd ever come across. And for me, it was kind of jolt. And it forced me to think about all kinds of things, which I'm still sort of wrestling with. Is there another question? Sorry, at the back there.
Just coming back to maybe something that has exited the field of outside of work and then following up with what you just said, Lynne. I'm interested on the way that work made by indigenous people or people outside of modernism was once conflated with outside art. And in the kind of parallel history of that work, we find that in today's kind of ethnographic museum or post-ethnographic museum, there's a general acknowledgement that the museum itself, while it can be a fantastic place to see this work and does have sort of epistemological value, it's also insufficient that the world might have other better places to see this work as well. And so my question is really, is there something that can be applied from that field to what we commonly think is outside of work now, which is, you know, rather than arguing for a kind of equality within an efficient system, is the museum really an intelligent
guess that also falls back to the imprecision of this term outsider art, which does embrace folk art, vernacular art forms, the work of people with disabilities, but just as you said, people whose trajectory just happened to be different. I mean, is the museum inadequate?
Well, maybe a certain type of museum that encourages a certain formation of values and hierarchies is, but again, I think there are many other examples of museums, and some of them are already among us upstairs, where those categories are much looser and complicated. And I always use the example of the Met. You go to the Met, everything is much more mixed. You go to the contemporary galleries at the Met, masterpiece, big painting, be stupefied by it, and no sense of context. So I think, for example, going back to what Matthew was saying about artist curated shows, you can think of those as temporary museums of sorts in which different types of methodologies are put in place. So I think different types of museums exist. We just take for granted that one kind of museum is the right one.
I think it's also true that Sheena Wagstaff's first rehang of the modern galleries at the Met recently started to embrace a more complicated story about what modern art might be. Larry?
Well, just a quick observation in terms of this. The art from these centers certainly looks one way in the museum. The way I presented it was, I had that one slide, and you could see it was looked great, but it was fairly conventional in terms of its presentation. One of the other features of the centers is that visitors, anybody, during the open hours, can go into the studios and see the work being made. So in the centers, there are actually two places that you can observe the work or interact with it. One is at a gallery, which in each of the three centers is modeled on the same principles of a museum. I mean, there are white walls and there's labels and they're lit and framed and what have you. But very close by, immediately adjacent to that, is the studio itself, which anybody can go into. You can sit down with the artists and join them at their work table. And that is a very different way of seeing work, which most museums don't offer. We did in the show The Possible that I talked about earlier, which was inspired by Creative Growth, Creativity Explored, and NIAID.
I think your question's a very good one. The discursive framework is absolutely of enormous power in shaping the way we receive an object, and the same object in an ethnographic museum will have a different narrative to it from if it's placed in a fine art museum. And I think we see that same movement back and forth if you think, say, of G's Bend quilts and the huge interest when they hit the press when the Whitney did that show in 2002, I think, and there was an enormous excitement. They were called some of the greatest abstract art of the 20th century and more. And so one would have expected to see them from time to time in the Whitney, and I know through your auspices, Rosalie Tonkin's quilt was bought for the Whitney. I have never seen them since, but the Philadelphia Museum also bought some Jews' Bend quilts, and they're in the textiles department, and they would be shown within a very different history. So it's not that one is right and the other is wrong, but it's what happens if we move these objects back and forth into different disciplinary frameworks that we see them differently, and I'm very much a proponent of making it fluid.
I think we have time for one final question, so we'll take the question in the front. Microphone's on its way. Patient. Thank you very much.
One of the things that I keep thinking about with what you have all been talking about is the viewer. And as a viewer, I realize that you're talking about things from the curatorial perspective. And as a viewer, I'm not often so much thinking about that. And it's not that I'm putting on you an educational element, but there's something that's so exciting to me about being a visual person, going to different museums, going out into the city, going into the country, being able to, going to the thrift stores, whatever. We're in a visual culture, and so there's something that's educational without being tendentious to me that I just think is really quite exciting about what you've done. So anyway, thank you.
So that it was a compliment.
Yes. Say thank you.
So that's not
say it again.
That's not the death of the curator, right? That's the continuing rude health of the curator. Well, I'd like to thank the panel, obviously. I'd like to thank you all for your patience and time. The galleries are open until 10 p.m. if you haven't had a chance to see Killer Heels or Judith Scott. Both are on offer at the Brooklyn Museum right now. And thank you again.